Welcome to another playoff edition of NHL Tonight. I'm Jamie Hirsch alongside with Brian Boyle and Mike Grubb. Just one game on this Saturday night slate, but it was a must-win game for the Seattle Kraken, and they were back at Climate Pledge Arena to a raucous home crowd, ready to will their team onto a victory and force a Game 7. With that, let's get right to the highlights. Again, Game 6, Seattle facing elimination, hosting the Dallas Stars, who had won two straight games heading into tonight with a chance to close out the series in Seattle. About 9 minutes into the first, Eli Tolvanen drops it here for Yanni Gourde. He's been so good this whole series. Drives the net hard and scores the Kraken strike first.
Yeah, they give you ice. You got to take it. Yanni Gourde knows that. Look at right at this point, he gets to this bad angle and he realizes, I could take this myself. And goes, drives the net. I'd like to see Harley, once he decides the Gourde's coming to the net, go at him. Try to force puck out of his hand. He doesn't. 1-0.
Just 31 seconds later, here come the Stars. Tyler Seguin finds a driving Mason Marchman, and he beats Philip Grubauer.
Picture perfect entry here for Max Domi. Kicks it into the middle where you have some speed. It's a hard play. Mason Marchman's driving on the puck on the dot line wide. And good things happen when you do the right things. They're all moving their feet. They're going hard to the net. It's a lucky bounce, but they'll take it.
Yeah, just like that, we're tied at 1. Under 5 to go. Jamie Benn gets called for tripping Alex Wennberg.
Yeah, I mean, I'm good with this call. I mean, Wennberg, great escape move, and Ben's going to finish his check, but he clips the legs out from Wennberg, and you got a power play here.
10 seconds in, Jaden Schwartz to Jordan Eberle, but a big save by Ottinger.
Ottinger standing tall here. He has to for this team to be successful. He's such a huge part of it. And at least early on a grade A chance, he stands tall.
About 1 minute after that, Tolvanen with a shot that stopped Eberle, picks up the rebound and buries it. The Kraken power play comes to life, taking the lead 2-1.
I like the pump fake right here by Tolvanen and just slide it back door. A little shot pass, trying to hit Jaden Schwartz. And then it's about everybody crashing the net. And Eberle uses his brains to kind of find that elusive spot by himself. And a beautiful backhand touch to put it home.
Let's go about 90 seconds into the middle frame. Gourde carries in, finds Oliver Bjorkstrand in the middle, and Eli Tolvanen back door, 3-1 Seattle.
You see the shots here, and it looks like Dallas may get caught in a change here. So they get beat up ice late. Yanni Gourde recognizes he can cut back, take some time. Shots are 16-5 for Seattle at this point. They're asking a lot out of Ottinger, but Tolvanen goes to the areas where he's going to get rewarded. He waits patiently. It's a great patient play and a net drive and a goal.
And again, more numbers for Seattle. Ty Cartier. What's his name there, Boiler?
Bling bling.
Yeah.
Cartier.
4-1.
Yeah.
Classy.
He's big time money. Look at that shot right there. He's been good in these playoffs, too.
Yes.
Great story. Getting his first taste of NHL hockey in these playoffs, and he just... his goal just chased Otter, and here comes Wedgie trying to flip the script here a little bit and see if he can get a little punch for the squad.
That was the shortest start of Ottinger's career. How about Oleksiak here getting called for interference on Jason Robertson? That puts Dallas on a power play. 15 seconds into the man advantage for the Stars. It goes out to the blue line. Miro Heiskanen winds up, and Joe Pavelski tips it home.
The rare Joe Pavelski deflection goal here. It could have been borderline, but you can't really review that. I think that's the only thing Seattle probably doesn't want to do. You don't turn it over at the blue lines, and you can't take penalties, and that's a tough one. You give them life.
Joe Pavelski, 8 goals this series in the third. A little over 20 seconds in, Pavelski hits the post.
Yeah, I mean, just that's the thing is we give so much attention, deservingly so, to his deflections. He's got a fantastic shot, too. Oh. Wires that one right off the bar.
And then 2 minutes later, Stars again. Pavelski over to Robertson, and he finds the iron unkind.
Yeah, Rupper, I know he doesn't score here, and you said it. It's a good sign he's getting the chances. This is a difficult one-timer to make when you're skating with that much speed into it.
Kraken here, 2-on-1. Eberle to Beniers, and the Kraken are up by 3, just like that.
Yeah, I mean, this Matty Beniers coming in here, gets the early pass. I think that's key. Give him a little bit of time here, and Beniers comes and shoots it short side, locker side on Wedgewood, and this place is getting loud.
Not to be outdone, though, the Stars trying to prove they're not going away easily. Just seconds later, they answer with Joel Caronte tipping it in.
Yeah, it's a basic shot, it seems, but Harley gets it through. He doesn't get it blocked. He sees two white sweaters coming out of the corner, going to the net. He puts it towards them because he knows it can cause some chaos. It's a great shot by Harley.
Here comes Eberle into the empty net. And the Seattle Kraken, to the delight of their sold-out crowd at Climate Pledge Arena, win this in dominant fashion, 6-3, your final, forcing a Game 7 Monday night in Dallas. Let's hear from Yanni Gord after the win.
What was the key to this contest?
I think we were really quick, transition quick, right back in their zone. I got our forecheck going, and eventually they break down, and we took advantage of it.
Yanni, your lid came off late in the third period. You couldn't get to it as you came back to the bench, and your teammate Ryan Donato was trying to give you his so you could get back out on the ice. What does that say, that gesture mean, about what this team is about?
Yeah, it's great. We have great teammates on this team. It's been so much fun playing together, and honestly, every teammate was trying to get me a helmet, but I knew my head is small, so it wasn't going to fit. But eventually got my helmet back and was able to go out there.
I'm glad you got your lid, because you're going to need it for Game 7. You guys were successful against Colorado in the first round in that scenario. What did you learn from that, and what will you take into Dallas come Monday night?
It was a great Game 7, but it's a new test tomorrow in a couple days, and we're super excited about it, and we've got to come out strong and reset after the first period.
How about Yanni Gord in his last three elimination games? Not bad at all. 5 points over that span. And another big night from him tonight in this must-win game for Seattle. But again, we say this over and over and over. No doubt, the Kraken, they've proven that they have resilience and they have the depth that is needed on all four lines to have anyone be the hero on any given night. On this night, it's 6 goals for them, 5 different goal scorers, doing it by committee, which is what they've done literally all season and into the postseason.
You know, and this is the thing that we're seeing. We knew this, but we're being reminded of it this playoff year. And there's one thing you can control when you go to the rink every night, and it's effort. Mm. And you can control. I mean, there's nights you feel like crud, right? You're going to feel like crap, but you're going to find a way to just put it all out there. And that's what you want from your players. But just, you can control that. I can't control bounces. I can't control passing lanes opening up or a shot or a bounce or a deflection, but I can control effort. That's all this team does. They just come with effort. That's what Florida Panthers do. They just bring effort. They let everything else just kind of fall as they may. And it's fun, because that's the way you want some very talented teams in this league to play. Just have a glimpse of that, yeah, and it can put them over the top.
What are you talking about?
Don't name names.
But these teams get it, and that's the foundation you could build with. Because now it's about, you know, all right, you can develop players, and you know, scoring goals is important. But having that MO of we're going to outwork you, or you're going to know that you're playing against us, the Seattle Kraken hit that one out of the park every night.
What do you mean to bounce back? Yeah.
It's contagious, though. You know this guy, every guy, you look across the room, everybody's bringing it.
No.
That adds the effort there, and then the only thing I'll add is the emotion. And, well, now it's a Game 7. They're going to bring the emotion, too. So it's those are fun to watch as fans. Those are fun to play in when you're a player. There's so much on the line, and you remember them forever.
Yeah.
Yeah. You guys have both played in a lot of Game 7s. We'll get to that mentality in a bit. But how about Jordan Eberle? You know, Rupert, you made the point earlier that there are a lot of guys on this team that have the experience. And even though the franchise is only 2 years old, don't discredit the names that are on this team. What do you mean of what Jordan Eberle has been able to bring to this franchise?
See, he's brought some leadership. He could do a little bit of everything. I mean, he's still got great hands, great vision. He's always had that. So, and let's not forget what he learned in his Islander days. He got pretty close there. And I think those days with the Islanders, he got better. He was asked to be better defensively. And that's an area that you probably didn't see from him early on in his Edmonton days. But, I mean, he could do it. That's the thing. All these guys can dabble in all areas of the game and thrive. Like, there's no one on this team where you're like, he is a specialist in this department. They're good in every situation, right? Like, I mean, that's what I find impressive with this group, is they can defend, they can play, they have scores. I mean, you know, no one that you're going to be like, this guy's dominant in this attribute, but very good in all of them. I think that makes you tough to play against, tough to beat.
I think you got to give Dave Haxtell some credit, too. He's got guys that, there were some guys off waivers. There were guys, younger guys, that have been on a couple different teams that they've put in certain areas that they can be successful in, right? And we say they have 4 second lines, but some lines play a little bit more than others.
Yeah.
But like you said, Rupper, like they don't have a lot of weaknesses as a team because the players themselves are fairly complete players, I think. They might – there's not one guy where if you shut him down on the power play, we won't have to worry about him for the rest of the game, right? There's no – like you said, there isn't really specialists. They have guys that do a number of different things well, but I think Dave Hakstol's put them in good spots. They've obviously built some chemistry. They all play a similar way. So if there's injuries or there's things have to move in and out of the lineup, they're a well-oiled machine. They're going the same way every night.
The last thing I want to say, and that this is a compliment. It's not a slap in the face. Nobody on that team is good enough to be one-dimensional. Mm. You understand what I'm saying? Like they got to this point in their career and playing in the NHL because they had to develop all areas of their game.
I like it.
For the most part. So none of them are so talented that they can. My shot is what I'm known for in the NHL. They don't have that.
Right.
So if you're here. You're here because you're doing other things.
Yeah.
So, yeah, you're right. Dave Hakstol, great job with this group. They're believing. They're making me a believer. Still got Dallas in game seven, but you can prove me wrong once again. We'll see.
Yeah, and we also should give a quick shout-out to Philip Grubauer, who, by the way, you know, just stepped up when they needed to, when they needed him to. He did that in spades. On the other side, you have Jake Oettinger, who had a pretty – rare performance by him, right? He got the hook and allowed four goals, and some of them kind of questionable. His series has been such a roller coaster for a guy that we've come to expect great things out of. How do you explain it?
I think this pull in this game was more that just getting ready for game seven.
Okay.
I don't think this was all the pull in this game was on Jake Oettinger, but I think the one thing that concerns me with Jake Oettinger is what you see. He's hot or not.
Right.
And that is tough to know because you got a one game to decide the series. I would think that he'll bounce back. I mean, I believe he is the best goalie left in the playoffs with Sergei Bobrovsky, but it's one game. You never know.
Right. I don't know what he's supposed to do on three of these four goals. I honestly don't. I think it looked like, even on Eberle's goal, it looks like maybe you could question his rebound. But it looks like he's, Ilya Tovanen, who has a bomb, is going to wind up and blast one, and he kind of just throws one to the far side. He gets a toe on it, he lets it go. It's going wide, maybe, but he was under siege early. I mean, the shots at one point were 16-5.
Right.
You got to just give him some rest and let him regroup because I think he'll bounce back with a great game in game seven.
Yeah. And remember the last time he played a game seven? For those of you who may not have that, easily recalled, it was last year, first round of the Stanley Cup playoffs, an epic series between the Stars and the Calgary Flames, and he made 64 saves in a game seven loss. So I bet that still sticks with him. He was otherworldly. The team probably still remembers it, and I bet they give him a better effort in front of him to help him out in this game seven. What do you think?
Yeah, they'll bounce back. I think even just to get to the second round, you've got pushback, and I think we're seeing that with a lot of these games and how you're going back and forth. I mean, you could say the same thing in the Edmonton, Vegas game. You get pushback. You're going to have pushback. Dallas is going to push back next game.
100%. I mean, they got leadership. They got guys that have been there, guys that have been through long playoff runs that are still there, that they want it that much more for that city, for that franchise.
Yeah.
I love their mix. I have since, March. I really think they're a tough out. But again, Seattle, I can't sleep on Seattle, but I love Dallas too. It's a great series. Like you said, in the other series too, if anybody thinks they know what's going to happen in the next game of any of these series in the West, they're lying to you.
Yeah.
It makes it fun to watch.
It certainly is a treat to watch and to be a fan of the game this time of year. Speaking of which, we've got another big game six happening tomorrow night in the West. The Vegas Golden Knights will try to close things out. Connor McDavid and company will try to extend it to a game seven. Who has the edge? We'll discuss next. Welcome back. We've got a monster game six tomorrow night as well in the Western Conference. The Golden Knights will look to close out the series in Edmonton while Connor McDavid and company will look to bounce back. This has been a very physical series. And guess what? We're going to get both Darnell Nurse and Alex Pietrangelo back in the lineup with their respective teams. Let's hear from Petro about his one-game suspension.
Well, it's pretty obvious what's going on. I mean, there's some premeditated stuff, I'm pretty sure, coming at me, but they didn't really seem to care in the meeting, but I'll get up and take it. And, I'm not going to lay on the ice like what's going on we've been seeing. So I'll get up and play the game the way it needs to be played. He looked like he got hurt and he's out there the next shift. So, you know, Keeks felt, I'm sure, a little bit guilty, but you got to be proud of the penalty killer to step up at that point in the game. That was a big momentum swing for us.
Going back to last year of taking care of one thing at a time. And the thing that's immediately before us is that we have to try and find a win on home ice, a place where we feel comfortable. Today's order of business is to make sure that we're rested up, that we're in the right frame of mind, that when we go home, the preparation for tomorrow night's game starts today.
And that's all you can say, right? One game at a time. It's a must-win situation. And I always like Connor McDavid's chances when his back's against the wall, right? I think he's going to take this team and put it on his back. But that being said, Connor's only scored one 5-on-5 goal this entire postseason, one of his 7 goals. Meanwhile, the Golden Knights have scored far more than Edmonton at 5-on-5 this series. Do you think that's going to be a big key for the Oilers if they're going to win tomorrow night?
I mean, you would think so, because I think the number one objective for Vegas is, like, we're not going to take penalties. Like, yeah, we're going to give ourselves a chance to close out this series. So if they don't take penalties and you don't put the Oilers on the power play, then you should feel really good about your chances, because they have been struggling 5-on-5. And that, to me, is where Vegas is a better team. So it's all going to be about that. For me, guessing, if Vegas can take 3 or less penalties, they win this game. They take more than 3, they're making themselves putting themselves in a tough spot for the Oil.
It's a tall task, always, but you don't want to. It's kind of a catch-22. You have to play a physical brand of hockey against Edmonton. You have to play with some abrasiveness. You have to be physical. You have to put pucks in the right areas and go and forecheck, because that is what's going to neutralize that offense. And sometimes when you do that, you're going to end up taking some penalties. Now, the penalties earlier would kill it. Like, they're killers for them. They start out in the hole. It didn't actually matter last game, but this is a physical series. You just don't want to take anything that's needless. You don't want to take anything in the offensive zone. You're going to have to defend them, and they are going to have to take some penalties. And like you said yesterday, hopefully they learned something on that 5-minute major that they had to kill. Yeah, they gave up a goal. They gave up 3 in the game on the penalty kill, but
they figured it at the right time.
Yeah, maybe they figured something out, something to neutralize them, or at least make it a little less dangerous.
And we will see, as I mentioned, both Pietrangelo and Darnell Nurse back in the lineup after each serving a 1-game suspension. Do you think that will factor into this? I mean, that physicality, that kind of almost revenge mindset, or do you think both teams are more interested in trying to keep it clean and stay out of the box?
I think those two guys individually, I should say, they both... You kind of hurt your own team. Both of them did. So you're going to still play your way, but you're not going to go out of your way. Like, you're going to go back and make an impact here. And both guys, whether you're talking about Darnell Nurse or Petro, they mean a lot to their teams. So this series is not going to lose any bite. You just got to be a little smarter with it, right? Like, can't take a dumb retaliatory penalty after a whistle, just punch a guy in the face. So I think that they'll get away from that.
It's honestly, like, it sounds like Petro wants them to get fired up. He's kind of firing up Edmonton to do something like that, almost kind of baiting them.
Yeah.
He knows he took his medicine. He had to sit out. Probably killed him to have to watch that game. But these are big minute defensemen. They have to be smarter, and they know that. Say whatever you will, if they're fortunate or not, there was only 1 game. But, I mean, I think it's too important to their team. They have to play their position. They have to be stingy defensemen. They're going to log 25, 26 minutes. They're back. They're ready to play, and I think they got the nonsense out of the way.
Yeah, how about McDavid swinging at Petro in that clip that we just showed you as well? Also, a situation in goal worth watching, right? Stuart Skinner got the hook yesterday, and so going forward, you know, how is his confidence? He is a rookie goalie. Do you expect him to bounce back really strongly, or is there some question in goal?
I mean, from the times we've seen him speak and the way he carries himself, he seems cool as a cucumber all the time. So I think that he would be just fine managing this. I don't know do you sit there and look at a more tried goaltender in Campbell, or do you go with Stuart Skinner? I'd go with Stuart Skinner.
Yeah.
You know, I feel like he's the guy who got you here. But we'll have to see. I mean, that's been quite the story. It's a lot of pulls, and we've been seeing that, though, across the playoffs. Like, goalies getting pulled left and right, but they got a little decision, I think, here in Edmonton, who they're going to go with.
If you look at that board, every other game he's thrown up a gem, really. He's given up 1 every other game that he's gotten pulled.
Yeah.
So I think you stick with him. He kind of got you here. He was good enough and solid enough where you could count on him. The unknown, the wild card, is what coaches hate, really. You know, you just need solid solid goaltending where you're standing in front of him, defending the harder areas, the dangerous areas. Make sure he makes the saves he's supposed to, because you have the weapons up front that can change the game for you. He just needs to be, frankly, ordinary, I think, to give them a great chance to win, and that's the guy I think you go with.
I've always thought, too, and maybe more in a situation where you have a true backup, and you know, Jack Campbell was supposed to kind of be the guy as far as being there, and that didn't necessarily work this way this year. But I wonder, I always thought that if in a situation like that, if you were to go to the backup goaltender, it kind of sends a message to the players, like, we don't feel very good right now, do
we?
You know what I mean? Like, that's why I always felt like...
You got to give them that confidence.
I want to push all that negativity out of my own head. We're always questioning our own selves and trying to stay positive. And I'd be like, wow, we're in a spot, I think, because this has been the consistent. Now it's not. So I wonder how much of that goes into these coaches' decisions. But, I mean, I thought about it as a player, so.
Yeah, no, it's very interesting. I mean, even with the Devil situation, right, they talked about maybe Black would come in. They went with Akira Schmid because I think that was the no-panic move. Didn't work out. They lost the game. But I don't know. Interesting conversation to think about going forward with Game 6 and the Oilers season on the line, 10 o'clock Eastern time. That place will be rocking at Rogers Place tomorrow night. Speaking of Game 6s, how about this one in Seattle? We'll continue to break it down right after this on NHL Tonight.
Gord, right circle, nice toe drag, cuts in front, score! Yanni Gord, toe drags the defender, puts the first shot on goal, gets his own rebound, and hammers it in. 1-0 Seattle. Gord into the slot, Nordstrand on the back door, they score! E.T. put it home, Ellie Tolvanen, a 3-1 Kraken lead, it's Tolvi time!
Dominant performance by the Seattle Kraken on home ice to force a Game 7. That'll be Monday night in Dallas. By the way, Pete DeBoer's teams happen to be 6-0 in Game 7 throughout his coaching career. Let's hear from the Stars coach after this loss.
I mean, we knew they were going to come out fast. You know, just didn't help ourselves, you know. Turn pucks over when the other team's hungry like that in an elimination game. You've got to, and you're on the road. You've got to at least be the smarter team, you know, with the puck. And I thought we compounded our mistakes and fed their energy in the first period. Tough time of year to beat any team three games in a row. We won 4, we won 5. It's a big ask. So it's a reason you play all season is to have home ice in a game 7 like this. And we've earned that, and, you know, hopefully we'll use that to our benefit.
There's a couple things, trying to get back to the pace that we knew we needed to play with. I mentioned and talked about, you know, before the game, how we, you know, how we're going to counteract, you know, some of the things that they were doing and did really well. Our starts haven't been, you know, we came through the first round, our starts were really good. You know, we haven't been able to establish that as well, you know, this series. And, you know, I thought we started, you know, we started pretty good on the road the other night, but all of a sudden we're down by 2. So it was nice to, you know, to feel good about, you know, the way that we started, as well as, you know, have some of the results. Obviously, we gave the momentum back real quick with them getting their first goal, you know, quickly after. But when you feel the momentum in the building and the energy in the building, that was an important way for us to start tonight.
All right, we love Game 7s, right? And Seattle Kraken are going to experience their second straight Game 7 after taking down the defending Cup champion Avalanche in Denver just last round. So they've got experience, but let's go something a step further, right? Their roster in Game 7 record is 34-5. So when you think about Seattle as this new team, they've got experience and they've got great experience. Shane Schwartz, by the way, 5-0 in Game 7s. You guys both have pretty good records too in your Game 7 career. So take us inside that dressing room, both dressing rooms for that matter. What is this mindset like for these two teams?
Well, it starts now, right after the game, whether you won it or you lost it, you reset, you understand that, hey, we got one game to advance. You know, if we win the game, there's only 4 teams left to win a Stanley Cup. You get excited about it a little bit, but then you have to refocus. I think it starts, then you go to the next day, you do it one thing at a time. You have your meetings. Okay, what did we do well? What did we do
poorly, and how do we fix it? What are the areas that are giving them momentum and giving them chances? It's all about all those things, so that when it comes down to game time, you get excited, you bring emotion, but you're not, you know, overwhelmed, or you're not kind of psyching yourself out. And that's kind of the game. The team that's best prepared brings the right amount of emotion and plays the most solid hockey game and limits the mistakes usually has at least a good start and comes out on top. It's about kind of keeping your poise, but also that balance of also bringing the same amount of emotion that you need in a big, big game.
Yeah, I think that the word balance is really key. Mm-hmm. So you got to balance a lot of things. You got to balance the emotion and at the same time, you want to bring a high level of of physicality to it, but you got to be really smart too and not do anything out. I mean, you feel like you want to explode. You know what I mean? Like you literally feel like you want to burst. And so how do you manage that? Like you got to chill out at certain times and just kind of, just funnel it the right way. I think that's the best way of putting it. But it's also about the balance of, yes, this is a serious moment, but it's a fun moment. You know, this is fun. This is what we grew up wanting to do and the positions we want to be in, but also then having the guys around the room that can joke around. Yeah. You have the guys that are serious. The worst thing ever, though, is when you get in a room and it's like someone that was joking around all year, and then you get into a big game or a game seven, and all of a sudden they got the mean face, right?
Yeah.
And they're not talking. And then I'm like, dude, we're in trouble. Like, you know what I mean? Just be yourself.
Right.
So everything you've done up to that point. So I think that's the biggest thing. These teams know that. They've had the experience. Most relaxed team. I like the chances with that. So
yeah, which one is that? I'm trying to think of the characters in both rooms and like who might have the edge.
I think Seattle is playing. I hate saying house money because that makes it like they shouldn't be here.
Right.
They deserve to be here.
Fair.
No one thought they were going to be here. No one thought they were going to probably be in the playoffs this year. You know what I mean? So, like, what do they have to lose? Like, I think that's free. That's a freeing thing. And and you heard Dave Haxtell say before the game one of kind of the safe as death type scenario. And, I mean, I love when coaches say that. Oh, you're telling me just go? Let it all hang out? All right, that sounds like fun. So we'll see. I think Seattle doesn't have pressure.
Well, he knows his team, and he knows his team defense, and they don't play high risk, but they go after it. Look, I think Jamie Benn's a pretty cool customer.
Yeah,
I think he can keep it loose. He competes really hard. They've been in situations like that.
This is why they get Pavs, right?
Or, you know, Joe Pavelski is probably going to score a goal in game seven.
He's probably played in,
you know,
87.
It's been an awesome series. Unfortunately, somebody has to go home.
Yeah.
But just enjoy it. Like, don't let the moment get the better of you.
Yeah.
Enjoy this moment because I'm so jealous I don't get to play in game seven. It's the greatest thing in playoff hockey is the most fun hockey, and game sevens are the best.
You think first goal wins? Or is that not going to end up being as critical?
No, I don't know. It's just serious. How do you handicap it?
I don't think either of these teams have been a lockdown team in the series yet. So I don't think the first goal necessary. The first goal means a lot, but it doesn't mean you're going to win the hockey game.
Yeah. I was going back to their game seven against the Colorado Avalanche, and they did score first, although they scored first in all seven of the games against the Avalanche, and that's something they haven't really done, the Kraken haven't really done this series. But it was a 2-1 Game 7 win for the Kraken. So you're right, it was that contained, disciplined style that I bet we'll probably see another low-scoring game, don't you think?
Yeah, I would think just because I expect Jake Oettinger to, again, not to say he was bad in this game. I actually thought that it was more the defending in front of him or the lack thereof. But I think this is the moment where he will rise to the occasion. So I don't see Seattle scoring more than three goals against Jake Oettinger maybe in the game seven. If I had to guess, might be dead wrong, because usually I'm when we're talking about the Kraken. But on the other side too, it's like the Seattle Kraken are playing a certain style. In the regular season, the Kraken give up goals. Well, I mean, they still do now to some degree, but I don't know. I could see Jake Oettinger having a performance though. I don't know. That's where I'm at.
Yeah, I think a couple D on the on Dallas are going to have a better game than they did today, too. So maybe it is going to be a low-scoring game.
Yeah.
I don't know. Who knows?
Well, I've already told you that the Kraken have a lot of experience with their players in Game 7s, and it's really good experience. But on the flip side, then, you go to Dallas, and they actually have won 8 straight games after a loss going back to mid-March, which was when Boiler really became a believer of this team and did not sleep on Seattle since mid-March, right?
Yeah, I said Dallas is going to win the Cup in March, and then now I'm a big Seattle guy.
I'm in a pretzel, and listen, I'm enjoying it. We're going with it. It's lots of fun.
All right, it is fun, and we'll be there for it Monday night. Quick break here on NHL Tonight, and when we come back, we turn our attention to the Eastern Conference side of things. Those two series, or those two opponents, are set. We'll preview it next.
Expectations for this team based on winning the President's Trophy, sky high.
The 22-23 season begins.
Here's Barkov, and that's a trick! Barkov with three goals in the first period.
Matthew Tkachuk fits with every team in the league. He's a playoff hockey type player.
First patty is a Panther! They got another one! Matthew Tkachuk and Carter Verhaeghe are blowing the lightning out of the building. It's 7-1 Panthers. What a night!
Smiles all around as the Panthers are in desperate need of wins.
Another gorgeous goal!
So the Panthers are going to make this big run. It's going to be because Bobrovsky is playing at the elite Vezina Trophy level that he can in goal.
Oh, what a save!
And oh boy, Sergei Bobrovsky, he's bringing sexy back.
The playoff chase continues. The Panthers are alive and well.
The hottest team in the NHL.
Make it six in a row for Lion and the Panthers.
Every point's extremely important for us, and we realize that. And, you know, we're trying to bring it every single night.
The second Panther ever to reach 40 goals in a season. Let's go! A franchise record, 7 goals in a period. I've never seen anything like this.
The Panthers are headed back to the playoffs for the 4th straight season.
Game 1 here in Boston, the Panthers and Bruins. But we're heading back to Boston, and the series is 3-1.
They score! Matthew Tkachuk wins it in overtime!
Boys, remember this room. We'll be back here for 7.
Buster in it! Shoots and scores! And 2!
They say cats have 9 lives. They are alive and kicking.
Brandon Montour does it!
The Panthers have tied Game 7.
Carter Verhaeghe did it! Let's go home, baby! The biggest upset in NHL history.
Round 2, Game 1 from Toronto.
You can't ask for a better start to a playoff series than this.
The Florida Panthers come to Toronto.
Scotiabank Arena has never been quieter than it is right now.
How about the confidence that this Florida Panthers team has right now?
Sam Reinhart gives the Panthers a 3-0 lead in the series.
The Rats are out.
Spring has turned to winter, and the Leafs are wilting and falling off the trees.
The Panthers win it. They take the series in 5, and the Florida Panthers are going to the Eastern Conference Final.
And we have made it to the Eastern Conference Final, which, just like everyone predicted, right? The Florida Panthers will face the Carolina Hurricanes. Canes have home ice, so Game 1 will start in Raleigh, and you're looking at their regular season splits. Canes taking 2 of 3. However, it's worth noting the Panthers did not have Sergei Bobrovsky in any of those 3 meetings. Spencer Knight for 2 of them out, line for the 3rd. So the Bob has been the story of the postseason for the Florida Panthers, and he's the reason why they are where they are. But I got to be honest with you guys, I don't really know what to make of this series right now in terms of who has the edge, because I think you could make an argument for both teams. Let's start with Carolina's defense, though, because that's been a real story this postseason. Why do you think that might be the difference maker?
It's the best decor in the NHL. I think that they're solid defensively. I think if you're just to look at their decor, they're very good defensively, and they're solid. I think Jacob Slavin is the best shutdown guy in the league. But I think it's their team defense mm-hmm. that makes them very difficult to handle. But their decor offensively is lights out. I mean, best numbers in the NHL. And I think that makes up for some of the injuries that they've had up front.
Right.
They connect the dots with their forwards. They get shots through better than Brent Burns, I think, is the best in the National Hockey League with getting shots to the net. But we also saw Brett Pesce. I mean, he thrived the one game with that, too. And every single guy, Chatfield, Gosh Spare's got that big shot. I mean, they get shots through, and I think as a forward, I love that. Get the puck out high, beat my defenseman to the net. The puck's going to be there. We're going to have a chance to score, and I think that's what makes them very dangerous.
As a forward, when you know the D are going to bring pucks to the net, they're going to get it there, or at least to a certain area, you're a lot more willing to get there and take the
bumps. A lot more willing to give them the puck, too, because, like, I remember you kick it out high and they get blocked. Eventually, I'm like, hey, playing together, I'm like, Brian, I'm not passing it to them anymore.
We're going back behind the net. We're going behind the net.
Yeah, we'll go behind that. We'll cycle it. So I think it helps out a lot when they get it through.
Absolutely. I think it's exciting to give it to them, and then you find a way to get to the net. A lot of times they can hold it. They're patient. A lot of times they get rid of it right away. And if everybody's on the same page and you know they're going to do that, it's so hard to defend. If Brent Burns is taking one-timers to the far post, if he hits the net or not, the left defenseman's coming down the wall if it goes wide, and they're just going to do that three or four times like he did in San Jose. Yeah. Now you're defending for a minute, minute and a half, opens up lanes for guys. They're the story for that team. But they, like you said, Rupper, they defend in fives. Their team plays a certain way. It's a lot like we talked about with Seattle. Like, if a guy gets injured, and we've seen a lot of injuries in Carolina, guys get plugged into the lineup, and they don't miss a beat. Different guys have had different roles. They've elevated their game. You know, you got a guy like Brady Shea who had 18 or 19 goals during the regular season this year.
Incredible. I didn't even mention him in that. Unbelievable.
Their D are a problem for the team they're playing against.
Yeah.
And they can do it on both ends of the rink.
Can I transition this to Florida now?
Go for it.
All right. Sure. So, but here's the kicker in it all. The one team out there that we've seen in the playoffs right now that has kind of taken the legs out from the other team's defense is the Florida Panthers and
right.
their forecheck.
True.
So this is where that this is the key matchup for me, is because you go back to the Boston series or you go against Toronto. I mean, the way that Florida handled Toronto, that group in Toronto, the forward group, talented.
Sure.
Like they are talented. I thought they would beat Florida. And instead of trying to contain the talent that they have there by focusing on those four players, the big four, they went at the D-core. And they're like, all right, here's the deal. You're not going to deliver them the puck clean. They're not going to transition out of their zone clean. And they kind of took the knees out. I think they did the same thing against the Bruins. They're forechecks everything. So how is Carolina's great D that we talked about going to handle that? And because if they can't handle it, they don't have the forwards that are still going to be able to score. Like, they need their D to be a part of the play. So that to me is the game inside the game between these two squads. No secret why Florida's here. Their forecheck has been tenacious so far in the playoffs.
That's an awesome point you made. And if you see it, if you go back to the Boston series and you see how that games 5, 6, and 7, that was a different Bruins team that they were playing against because of what you just talked about. Mm-hmm. That. Every hit, we used to say, every hit in the playoffs is an investment.
Yeah, it's like putting money in a bank, right?
Exactly, and it might not do a whole lot there to the casual fan. It might not do a whole lot to the other. You might not even see what it can possibly do, but it wears on players. It is the farther you go in the playoffs, the more hits these guys are taking. If you can put pucks in areas, I say it all the time, but you make the D turn, it's going to be a longer night for whichever team. And whoever does a better job of that is going to win the series.
No. Wow. I always thought of it, you know, it's like every single time. You know how your buddies, you punch them in the shoulder? And you got that one buddy who was a teenager always punching in the shoulder. Eventually, when you go and see him for something, you're like, oh, you know.
Yeah. You're
easy. You know what I mean? Like, and eventually, you're like, all right, dude, I don't want to get hit in the shoulder anymore. So, like, that's like the D going back. And it doesn't, it's not that it has to hurt every time. You don't have to run them through the boards. The Florida's doing it. They bump them. Now all of a sudden,
stop completely.
Now all of a sudden, and then you talk about getting tired in the playoffs. Now you have to stop on plays because you can't just flow and just keep your legs moving the whole time. Now it's like all of a sudden these D are going to get the puck. They know because it's happened 32 times already that they're going to get bumped up, so they rush the play.
Yeah.
Like, I don't want to get hit right when I'm making my pass, so they rush the play. Now it's off.
And
now the forwards aren't receiving clean passes. They have to stop on a puck. And then you've got it just starts everything into this snowball effect. So Florida's been incredible. That's been their MO. Bob's been incredible. I don't know where the series goes. Both teams have been really, really spectacular so far in these playoffs.
Well, you brought up Bob, which brings us to my next point, the goaltending, right? I mean, I think right now, if you look at this, you're obviously going to say Bobrovsky has the edge, right? Just because of how out of his mind he's been playing. But going into this postseason, I think you'd argue that Carolina's goalie tandem was really good. And Raanta seems to be like he's healthy now. I'm sure they'll start Freddie, right, in game one, you would think. But they've got two serviceable goalies for Carolina as well.
They got three with Kachekov, too. So, I mean, they've got some answers. So I think they're in a good spot. Like you mentioned, I would think Freddie starts this series.
Yeah.
But they're also in a great spot because if they need to shake it up or find something else, Antti Raanta has been really good at different times. And quite frankly, I thought before the playoffs even started, I thought we'd be seeing Kachekov in net.
Right.
So, I mean, they've got some nice stories in between the pipes. But I think all of that is because of the structure that you were just talking about, the five-man defending that happens in front of it. It gives all their goaltenders an opportunity to succeed because they're predictable. These shots are predictable where they're coming from. That's the difference. And Bob has had to be, like, magnificent. I don't know if Freddie Anderson and Antti Raanta has had to be magnificent. They've been good. Mm-hmm. But I think that goes to the guys in front of them.
Yeah, they dominated. And to your point, I mean, if you do see their goalie, they've done it before. They've kind of handed the net off before. I think there's a good relationship there. They're all about winning. So, yeah, we might see both. But who knows? I think it's more important how Carolina plays. That's their key to success. Mm-hmm. I think if Florida goes into Carolina and gets one out of two, that's a big, big win. I think Carolina starts games. They're going to start a series. This is a different team that Florida's playing, a different discipline, a different brand of hockey. Mm-hmm. And it's a really hard place to play. So if Florida can get one of them, you know, we said that last series and they took them both, but... Yeah, who knows? It's tough to predict. I just hope it's another entertaining series, and I'm sure it will be.
Well, I mean, you mentioned how hard it is to play in that building. Yeah, over the last two postseasons, the Canes have two losses in the playoffs on home ice, and they have home ice advantage in the series, so we'll see how that plays a role. Also, Paul Maurice, kind of funny comment after winning last night. He talked about how he feels very old because he actually coached all three of the guys on the bench as part of the Hurricanes coaching staff. So just kind of one of those full circle life moments. It'll be fun as they go head to head coming up soon. When we come back, the season is over for the New Jersey Devils. Thanks to Brent Burns and the Carolina Hurricanes. We'll talk about what might be next for New Jersey. Stay tuned. The door has shut on the New Jersey Devils this season, but what a year it was. They set a franchise record in both wins and points. Jack Hughes set a franchise record with 99 points, and of course they beat their ultimate rivals, the Rangers, in the first round for their first playoff series win in 11 years. As the Devils cleaned out their lockers on this Saturday, Lindy Ruff shared his view on the season.
Very proud of where things went, where we started. The goals we set, we felt we still could have been in the fight, but you got to get through that. And these guys gave me everything they had. Game five, they gave me everything they had. We just didn't converse.
There was conversations, you know, like if you can't help the team, then they don't want you in there. But I felt like I was ready to go, and obviously Lindy and Fitzy were good with that. So that's how that decision was made. I mean, you're at the end of the day, you're a competitor too. You don't want to be in the press box with the season on the line, so... I know I'd have a pit in my stomach if I was in the press box for that game. I'm not the GM by any means, you know, so it's not my up to me. But, you know, I think they want to come back. I know you got to get it done, too. You can't just talk about wanting to be in New Jersey. If you want to be in New Jersey, you got to just sign the deal, you know. So those guys are obviously big parts of our team, and we'd like to have them back.
It's, you know, it's fresh after our loss, and you just kind of, you know, want to take a couple days, and obviously it's not a great feeling being out, but there's some conversations that are going to be in, you know, decide the future. So yeah, that's going to be a topic this summer for sure. But as of now, you know, just kind of, you know, this team definitely we're heading in the right direction. And if you look at the progress from last year, that's it was a quick turnaround, and it just kind of shows the skill and the talent of this group.
And that's coming from a guy who's only been with this group for, 2 months or so? And that is kind of one of the big questions going forward, is whether or not Timo Meier will indeed stay with New Jersey. You see the number of guys who are either RFAs or UFAs in just about a month's time. I mean, they've got some big-time decisions to make, Rupert. Where do you see them prioritizing things?
I mean, the first two guys on the list, Meier and Brett, I think they will get them both signed. I don't think you make that move without Timo Meier knowing that, you know, you're going to be able to extend him. So, but they've got some wiggle room with the cap space, and then potentially players that they might not, they probably already realized they couldn't, they're going to have to let go. I think even on the back end too, you got, I mean, anytime you're taking that next step and you're going to be a contender, which this team is looking to take that next step next year, you need entry-level contracts on your roster, and you need them to perform. I think that they have the potential with, clearly, Luke Hughes on the back end. And then whether it's Nemec or if it's one of these other young defensemen, I mean, that's another area that they can get an entry level on the back end, save them some cash to go and fulfill the rest of their roster.
Absolutely. I mean, Nemec has been high in everybody's list of he's the next guy to come in. And obviously Luke Hughes has been a great talent. And he can kind of handle that spotlight. I thought he did great. I wanted him in earlier in the playoffs. Mm. And you never know where it's going to go. I mean, Damon Severson's been there a long time. He's a UFA. The money's going to have to work if they want to bring him back. But it looks like maybe he'd probably make more on the open market. I don't know. Can you bring Graves back? The RFAs, usually, if you can, you keep them because there is some sort of ballpark you can keep them in.
Yeah.
And, you know, you never know. It's there's going to be change. There's always change. And that's... the pros and cons of having a successful year with a number of guys having
right.
big numbers. It's they got to go.
The one spot I think in net, I think maybe just because he hasn't stayed healthy, I think this might be the end of Mackenzie Blackwood's time there. That's possibly something they do there. But then there's the other interesting ones, like Eric Holloway is one for me. He's UFA, but I'm thinking to myself, I'm like, he was awesome in these playoffs.
Yeah.
He found a home on a good line. So it's about making that money. You got to ask yourself as a player, is it better for me to prolong my career more and be in this spot than about the actual dollar amount right now? I think he needs to stay in Jersey.
Mm.
He helped Hughes a lot too early in the year.
Yeah, he did.
Yeah, well, decision time is coming in Jersey either way. We roll on with our coverage of the Stanley Cup playoffs here on NHL Tonight. Thanks so much for joining us all postseason long.